On August 12, 2020, a stream clip from a socialist political commentator named Vaush went viral on Reddit. The clip detailed Vaush's disdain toward the burning or bust mentality and outlined his position that voting for a candidate with only a limited number of progressive policies would be preferable to allowing an incumbent authoritarian to have a second term in office. The clip made its way onto Reddit and eventually followed its way onto r/breadtube, a subreddit known for fostering a considerably far-left community. Now, some of you listening right now could be forgiven for thinking that such a statement wouldn't be met with a particularly strong level of backlash in a subreddit comprised mostly of leftists. To this, I would say, you haven't been on the internet for very long, have you? Within just a few days, the clip would become the longest thread in r/breadtube's history, with over 1,764 comments of people engaging in a heated flame war of epic proportions, which ultimately ended in one of breadtube's moderators slamming a lid on the gurgling pot by completely locking the thread from the public and proceeding to delete every single comment from existence. How in the sweet name of baby Jesus did we get here?
I hate breadtube.
So yeah, I'm just over the whole lefttube thing at this point.
I have done a less than stellar job of expressing my problems with the left.
Now, I could spend this entire video explaining how progressive Joe Biden is relative to his predecessors, and how his environmental, social, and economic policies will act as a much-needed stepping stone toward more reformative leftist policies in the future. But the aforementioned Vaush video makes that argument way better than I ever could. The big question that I hope to seriously answer in this video is as follows. How did we get here? For some, the Vaush fiasco is emblematic of one of the great rifts in online lefty spaces, that between progressives who choose to support Joe Biden in the general election, and those who would rather experience an ice pick lobotomy. I, however, saw this clusterfuck as a symptom of a greater issue, one that seems oddly specific to my side of the political spectrum, that being the left's almost overt repulsion to the idea of uniting on any sort of ideological front. Right-wingers rarely seem to have this problem. People might look to certain small puddles of conservative dissonance, or the few larger groups like the Lincoln Project, as some sort of evidence that the right isn't a united front. But these groups are few and far between. You can find old clips of many current Trump allies speaking very unfavorably regarding the president, ranging from political figures like Lindsey Graham and Ted Cruz, to media voices like Steven Crowder and Ben Shapiro. These guys were all outspokenly against Trump during the 2016 Republican primary, but almost completely switched over to solely criticizing the opposition party once Trump actually won the nomination. So instead of asking how did we get here, I think that a better question to ask is this. Why is it that conservatives have such an easy time coalescing, while leftists not only seem to be unable to unify, but seem to almost excel at tearing each other down? While many have tried to answer this question based purely through a lens of philosophy or political theory, I would like to, in this video, propose a different lens through which to view this issue, one that expands into the vast and underexplored field of moral psychology. Because yeah, it's in the title, obviously. You saw that coming. Come on.
About one of the most important creatures that man has tamed for his own use, the domestic hen.
If I had to recommend a single work of nonfiction that you should read before you die, it would be Jonathan Haidt's The Righteous Mind, a book that breaks down the history and inner machinations of moral philosophy in so profound a way that I wouldn't be able to encapsulate a tenth of it in just one video. Today, however, we'll be looking at two specific sections, one of which involves a particularly unlucky chicken. So here's a hypothetical moral dilemma for you, my viewers, from Heinz's book, and I want you to play along in the comment section below and let me know what your answer to this moral dilemma is. A chicken is hit by a car and left dead on the side of the road. Why it was trying to cross the road is completely irrelevant. A man sees this ordeal. He checks to make sure that he is unseen, and seeking to ensure that the good chicken is not wasted, takes said chicken back to his home, goes into the secrecy of his own basement, and proceeds to fornicate with the chicken. The moral dilemma is as follows. Is it immoral for the man to fornicate with the dead chicken? And why? Type away in the comment section below, that way we create the weirdest comment section in YouTube history. Now, there tend to be two major lines of ethical reasoning that people navigate when presented with this conundrum. The first group of you likely said something along the lines of the following.
While the prospect of committing such an act is no doubt disgusting, the chicken is dead and has no bodily autonomy. Since the man isn't hurting anyone, he technically isn't doing anything immoral, though, again, I myself would never fornicate with a chicken. Dude, you make me say the weirdest shit in your videos.
If your answer was something along those lines, you are likely from a Western, industrialized, rich, democratic nation, and are likely in the process of getting or have already received a college education. In other words, you would happen to fall under a category that Hyatt defines as, and I swear this is true, a category labeled as weird, which consists of people who tend to justify their ethics based on whether or not a given action inflicts harm onto others. Furthermore, according to Hyatt's findings, you are far more likely to politically identify as leftist, liberal, or libertarian. Cool. So if that's what the first group said, then what did the second group probably say?
What the actual hell? Yes, it's wrong to fuck a chicken. What the hell, bruh? Why is it wrong? I don't know. You could get a disease or something, or he could get caught. It's just not something you do!
Now I could challenge this line of reasoning, asking, well, is it immoral for an individual to do something that might give them an STI? Or repeat that the man is performing this act in the complete privacy of his own home. But at the end of the day, barring some special appeal to societal or spiritual authority, people in the second category tend to scramble to find someone being hurt, cannot do so, yet usually remain steadfast in their belief that the act is immoral. People who answer in this manner tend to also be more inclined to be politically right-wing or conservative. The reason we know this is because Hyatt asked a ton of people from different backgrounds this hypothetical moral dilemma, and I'm just here laying out his conclusions. I even repeated this study with my friends, and surely enough, my friends who tend to lean a little more right-wing, by Canadian standards at least, stood by their claims that the man was in the moral wrong, while the more progressive group said that he wasn't doing anything immoral. Hyatt also laid this other question out if you're interested in playing along, and yeah, if you want to, just leave it in the comment section. This one's interesting as well, but for different reasons. For complicated reasons that Hyatt outlines in the book in greater detail, he found that it was useful to look at moral appeals as taste receptors. Similar to how some people react to sweet and salty more positively than sourness and bitterness, six distinct moral categories were created in which different people tend to find some of these facets more appealing than others. These appeals are appeals to care or harm reduction, which we went over already, appeals to fairness or cheating reduction, appeals to loyalty and betrayal reduction, appeals to authority and subversion reduction, appeals to sanctity and degradation reduction, and appeals to liberty and oppression reduction. What Hyde found to be particularly useful about this model was that he was able to find very distinct differences between people who leaned politically left versus those who leaned politically right. What he found was that leftists tend to be especially sensitive to ethical appeals to care and fairness, whereas conservatives tended to be spread out across the board and valued all six of these categories about evenly. When using this framework, our chicken example suddenly starts to make a lot more sense. A lefty sensitivity to care and harm wasn't triggered by someone fornicating with an already dead animal, hence the claim that the act isn't immortal. A vegan leftist, however, might make the claim that the chicken has autonomy over its body even in death, and thus it isn't fair to desecrate its body even if it can't feel anything. This still remains aligned with Hyatt's theory because it is an appeal to fairness, which is also super common in lefties. I should also note that why these six categories appeal to some over others is, according to Hyatt, probably some combination of genetic and cultural, but at the end of the day, read the book if you want more information on that. What Hyatt's categories reveal most importantly, however, was that this divide in ethical lenses makes it so that lefties aren't particularly great at understanding or sympathizing with ethical lenses beyond care and fairness. And while there are many situations in Hyatt's book that prove this, I can think of no better example that proves this point better than the Destiny N-word saga.
That's a separate conversation! No, that's a separate— I don't want to have that conversation!
We can have it in like 2 minutes!
I don't give a fuck about
then we'll have
conversation.
It. Well, I do care about this because you just earlier told Trihex that it was intrinsically dehumanizing for me to ever say the N-word privately.
Oh my goodness. While there are many moving parts to the Destiny N-word drama, the general gist of the moral dilemma is as follows. A streamer named Destiny argued that it was morally acceptable for a non-white person to say the N-word as long as that individual was in the private company of others who did not take offense to the word. This sparked a ton of backlash from many people. I won't be spending any time going over my own process for breaking down the ethics of saying the N-word in private, but what I do want to break down is the rhetoric that was used to try combating Destiny's argument. I got to hear so many different people try breaking down the argument, but they would typically go all over the place. But what if someone hears you say the word? Doesn't saying the word in private make it more likely that you're going to say it out loud? It's just not something you do. If you were around to see these debates, it was kind of like watching a schizophrenic trying to escape solitary confinement by smashing themselves against the padded walls. At the end of the day, if you do something in private and no one around you is offended, then you simply aren't hurting anyone. And you can't make an accusation of unfairness either, because no system of equity is being breached. What we see is the chicken dilemma, but on the other foot. Yeah, you lefties probably had a bit of an ego spike during the chicken bit, but now the shoe's on the other foot. Seriously, why is it wrong to say the N-word in private when no one hearing it is offended? Here's a nice and simple way to have gotten Destiny to understand where people were coming from. The moral transgression appeared not from the fact that Destiny was harming anyone, but in the fact that he was betraying the black people in his audience and in his personal life who saw him as an ally. Arguing that Destiny's action was a moral transgression on the grounds of his words being a betrayal of trust would have had a much better result than appealing to care and harm. Allow me to show you how I would have gone explaining this to Destiny. Hi, Destiny. I just want you to know that behind your back, and solely in the company of people who won't get offended by it, I like to call you Tiny Dick. Now, I know that my calling you that might offend you, but don't worry. I'm only doing it behind your back, where you'll never be able to hear it. Matter of fact, anytime you're not in the room, me and my friends all call you Tiny Dick. As a matter of fact, that's the only thing we call you. Hey guys, have you guys seen Tiny Dick's last debate? Hey, do you guys know if Tiny Dick's coming to the party? Hey, maybe Tiny Dick's gonna get some chicken, some fish filet, I don't know, maybe Tiny Dick will order a pizza. Hey guys, where's Tiny Dick? Ooh, Tiny Dick, yeah. Alright, you guys get the point here. The issue isn't that I'm harming anyone, but rather that I'm saying something behind someone's back that I know would hurt them if I said it to their faces. And here's the thing, Destiny isn't the descendant of an oppressed Tiny Dick group where being called Tiny Dicks was a slur for something they had no control over. Destiny didn't have Tiny Dick children who were called Tiny Dicks from across the halls. There were no Tiny Dick exclusive schools or Tiny Dick water fountains, and there is no deep bigoted history of being called a Tiny Dick. So if the thought of people doing that to you behind your back hurts you in any way, Destiny, well imagine how it must feel to have people call you a Nick.
It's not as fun to be called a reactionary by someone who is on the left. It's not as much fun for me. Not just because these things are lies. It's also because I really like left unity. I really like it. I like the idea of us getting along, you know?
So what does this all have to do with leftist infighting? Well, the political right, in terms of their moral framework, is hardwired to value loyalty at least as much as something like caring and fairness. Whereas the left, at least according to the data, cares significantly less about loyalty. This means that the idea of progressives staying loyal to a party in order to maintain political momentum is very tough for these people who already feel somewhat ostracized by the DNC's overtly pernicious moves toward them. It also explains why Dems asked Al Franken to step down for some admittedly tasteless jokes, but conservatives had no problem backing a literal sex offender in Roy Moore when he was up for re-election. For leftists, loyalty doesn't matter for beans, but for conservatives, loyalty literally matters as much as the word of God. You can also see evidence of this online as well. Have you guys ever heard of this website called Twitter? I certainly haven't. What I have heard, though, is that leftists on Twitter tend to fight. Like, a lot. Like, a lot, a lot, a lot, a lot. Vaush has a theory on this that I think is very apt. You don't get much street cred as a leftist for shitting on conservatives. It's such a simple, brainlet thing to do that even Shoe on Head does it. Ooh, burn! But what you can get cred for is shitting on liberals all the time, or shitting on your fellow progressives. You get massive points in your community for posturing toward a sense of moral purity. And because your brain doesn't give a fuck about group cohesion like conservatives do, nothing in your brain is stopping you from just going hog wild and shitting on your own side just because your brain rewards you every time you get a like from your fellow leftists. Does this do anything good for your movement? Fuck no. Does it feel good and makes you feel like you're setting yourself apart from your fellow so-called lefties?
Absolutely.
So now you get it. The next time you see your fellow lefties reject any type of unity, or even see yourself doing it, remember that it isn't any of your own choosing. Our brain chemistry literally won't let us value the one thing that can keep us from tearing each other apart. So what does this all mean for the left? Do we just acknowledge that we don't value unity and are too disparate to ever get along? Well, I have two suggestions. First off is that I want you all to remember to use appeals to care and fairness with lefties when arguing with them, and try not to be too dismissive of the other four when dealing with right-wingers. One of the reasons that Vaush is such a successful orator is that you can see him appealing to leftist sense of harm reduction when trying to get people to vote for Biden, as having Biden in office would not lead to as much harm as having Trump in office. But anytime you see him debating right-wingers, he seems to shift his rhetoric. Seriously, take a shot if you've ever heard him say, "As an American, I love freedom," even when talking about an idea as far left as worker-owned co-ops. Vaush says it like it's a half joke, but to some degree, he knows that he's appealing to conservative senses of liberty rather than their sense of care and fairness. This knowledge of the differences in our ethical frameworks doesn't have to confine us to inscrutable chaos and an inability to communicate. It merely suggests that we occasionally have to change our rhetorical styles when trying to change people's minds. Secondly, and most importantly, to any lefties listening, I want you, like me, to take the come pledge. Say it with me. C, stop arguing with lefties. U, getting more sleep. And M, don't get mad online. Engaging in healthy debate with people is super important, but make sure that you're doing it for the right reasons. If you're going to disagree with lefties publicly, that's fine. Just do like Vaush does, and let your audience know that you still support the positive role that your opposition has in your community, regardless of the qualms you may have with them. Listen, my fellow lefties, I know you're not happy that Bernie lost, which signals yet another long period of time before another lefty candidate can represent our movement in the United States. But our time will come. You can't control the way that you feel, but you do not have to fall victim to your own brain chemistry. You can still control the way that you act. Does the dopamine kick that you get out of memeing on liberals right before an election really help the cause? Or can we maybe wait just a few more weeks and then get back to it once the fascist is out of office? The choice is yours, really. And either way, I won't publicly judge you or get angry at you for it, even though part of my brain really wants me to. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. You guys are about to hear some of the snippets of me forcing my friends to take part in those moral dilemmas. So have fun with that. Lick, subscribe, don't be glib, and also subscribe to Vaush. Vaush is fucking awesome. Peace out, guys. See you in a bit. Enjoy the next video. It's gonna be on Blue Exorcist. Anime is good.
I guess it would not be moral to eat chicken, but I still eat chicken.
You hypocrite, Marco! Oh my god! Shame! Shame!
By the way, you are supposed to feel uncomfortable. It is all part of the process, I pinky promise you.
I still feel more comfortable than that chicken.
Well, everyone knows that I'm a murderer for Klondike, but...
Oh, no. Fucking liberals, man.
Liberals act like they wouldn't kill for a Klondike.
Exactly. Leftists are honest. They openly admit that they'd kill for Klondike.
Exactly.
Lordy lord. All right.
Don't want to because it's not good optics.
I love this so much.
For a Klondike ethno state.